At the turn of the 20th century, many different schools of art coexisted together. Some have continued 19th century traditions, while others have come to be as a result of contemporary masters' creative quests. Late Romanticism became one of the most prominent phenomena in the art of music. Its representatives were distinguished by their elevated interest in symphonic music and large-scale compositions. Composers had created complex philosophical programs for their works. Last third of the 19th century has seen birth of the new school, that of Impressionism, which began at first in French painting. Impressionist musicians have aspired to convey subtle and complex feelings, have sought exquisite and refined sound. So literary symbolism, also born in France, was particularly intimate to them. Increased sophistication in musical language and forms first manifested in late Romanticism, and then in other schools has brought to life neoclassicism, from Greek neo, new, appearing in European music in the first quarter of the 20th century. Composers sought to return to harmonic clarity, to simplicity of melody and form, to a beauty and approachability of musical language. They turned to polyphony, revived harpsichord music of 17th and early 18th century. There was also appetite for old-fashioned genres, such as suite and concerto grosso. One of such brilliant example is Maurice Ravel's suite Mother Goose. Its musical content is based on well-known literary fairy tales and has nothing to do with the famous collection of English nursery rhymes. This Mother Goose is French and has been known for her fairy tales since the late 17th century. In 1697, Charles Perrault collected some old and new tales in a book that became known popularly as Mother Goose. His collection contained, among others, the stories of Sleeping Beauty, Little Red Riding Hood, Puss in Boots, Tom Thumb, and others, with a moral at the end. Ravel was inspired by Pierrot's collection and other fairy tales when, in 1908, he decided to compose a short suite for piano duet, intended as a gift for Mimi and Jean Gadebski, the children of his friends. He orchestrated the suite in 1911 and expanded it into a ballet score. However, the work is more often performed in the original suite form, consisting of orchestrations of the five movements for piano duet. The first number in the suite, Pavane of the Sleeping Beauty, is inspired by a fairy tale of the same name about a princess cursed to sleep by an evil fairy, but awakened when a handsome prince has found and kissed her. Many a girl has waited long for a husband brave or strong, but I'm sure I never met any sort of woman yet who could wait 100 years free from fretting, free from fears. Now our story seems to show that a century or so late or early matters not. True loves come by fairy lot. Some old folk will even say it grows better by delay. Yet this good advice, I fear, help us neither there nor here. Though philosophers may prate, how much wiser 'tis to wait. Maids will be sighing still, young blood must, when young blood will. Composer did not retell the whole fairy tale, but only a single fragment, enchantment of the beautiful princess' long sleep. Ravel has chosen intonations of a lullaby closely connected to his own first images of childhood. His mother was Spanish and has certainly sung Spanish lullabies to him. Simple, austere, and somber, where each stroke, each contour is mercilessly precise and real, like the life itself. This is what we hear in this melody, tender and monotonous like a French lullaby, but also sad and inconsolable like a Spanish one, with short repetitive tones, which emphasizes mysterious magic of the evil fairy. Ravel had composed this part in the form of a slow Spanish pavan dance, known since the 16th century as the grave kind of dance, borrowed from the Spaniard, wherein the performers make a kind of wheel or tail before each other, like that of a peacock, went the name. One can say that this is a ritual dance song of sorts related to Spanish folklore. Ravel's orchestra is symbolic also. The main theme may be heard in tone in minor key in winds, flute, oboe, clarinet, accentuating intonations of a live human voice, and only at the end dissolves in the sound of strings, like in an infinite space of life. the next number in a suite, also from the Charles Perrault fairy tale collection, Tom Thumb, telling us about little children left by their parents in a dark forest, about their scary and dangerous adventures, when the smallest and the least loved of the seventh brothers, small and ugly Tom Thumb, helped them pull through. Children are a pride to all when they're handsome, straight, and tall. But how many homes must own some old maid who's seldom shown? Just a little pale-faced chap no one thinks is worth a rap. Parents, brothers, love him down, keep him mute with sneer and frown. Yet its little thumbling may bring them fortune one fine day. Music depicts and conveys state of a single fragment from this fairy tale, when Tom Thumb, not for the first time, tries to lead the lost children out of the forest. He thought he'd have no trouble finding his way back by following the breadcrumbs he'd left everywhere he'd gone. How surprised he was when he couldn't find a single one. The birds had come and eaten them all. It opens with a sad and lonely melody, the state of a lone Tom Thumb. Measured orchestral overture by the strings conveys motion and steps and constant change of measure from bar to bar. 2-4, 3-4, 4-4, 5-4. Uncertainty and confusion. The main theme, as in the first part, is given to the winds, expressing human voice of Tom Thumb and his brothers. Tense, step by step upwards movement can be heard in the melody with resentful, questioning intonation. Where are the crumbs I have left? Violence glissandos, sounds of twittering flute and piccolo give us a bird's song and flight as an answer. Affect everything. In conclusion, there are notes of despair. What are we going to do?
Thank you.
literary fairy tale Green Serpent was written by the Countess Marie Catherine d'Aulnois, famous writer and storyteller, an active member of the literary salons in Paris at the end of 17th century. It was first published in 1698 in a book, New Tales or Fairies in Fashion. The serpent is representative of a European dragon, a legendary creature in folklore and mythology among the overlapping cultures of Europe. The Roman poet Virgil, in his poem Culex, describing a shepherd having fight with a big constricting snake, calls it serpent and Draco, showing that in his time the two words probably meant the same thing. His description is, he has green wings, a many-colored body, ivory jaws, fiery eyes, and long bristling hair. At the turn of the 20th century, Countess d'Aulnois's fairy tales were often published as a supplement to fairy tales of Charles Perrault and included in his collections. It is not surprising then that Ravel read and admired her tales along with those of Perrault. In Green Serpent, plots of several folklore interpretations echo against one another, where in Sleeping Beauty, three fairies were invited to a birthday of one princess. Here, 12 of them arrive at the birthday of twin princess. In both fairy tales, everyone forgets about a fairy that foretells 100-year sleep of a princess in the Sleeping Beauty and to be the ugliest in the world for one of the twins in the Green Serpent. The Beast from Beauty and the Beast is the Green Serpent in the d'Aulnois fairy tale. Here there are also echoes of a classic Greek myth, Eros and Psyche. Maurice Ravel had chosen only one small fragment of the tale for his musical number. Moment when the ugly princess, having decided to quit the world, falls into a magical sleep and awakens in a gorgeous castle where she is greeted by little humans, pagodas and pagodinas. They throw a big feast for her with exquisitely spread table, with the richest table service, dress her in beautiful dresses and jumps, all the while accompanying the ceremony with the melodies played on their amusing instruments. Some had lutes made of walnut shell, others violas made of almond shell, for it was necessary to suit the instrument to their size. But everything was so exact and harmonized so well that nothing could be more delightful than these concerts. And for this little concert, composer uses interesting compositional and orchestral devices. Melody, for example, is based on pentatonic 5-tone scale, upon which Chinese, Vietnamese, Mongol, and Turkic people's traditional music is based. In this musical tale, there are three parts. First and third are composed in the manner of primitive dance. The second, more reserved, with intonations of sadness and solitude. Gradually, all quiets down, and the theme of a flute imitates the voice of the princess. How did I get here? Why am I here? Step by step, movement of chords in the lower register, hints of certain mysteriousness, something princess doesn't yet know. In the orchestra, composer creates imitations of jingling Chinese folk instruments using percussions, glockenspiel, triangles, and xylophone, piccolo flute, harp, and string pizzicatos emphasize fancy theatrical character of this number. Such character in composition is not essential. In the fairy tale, pagodas and pagodinas entertained the ugly princess every night by staging plays by Molière and Racine. Orientalism is also present here, a whole trend in development of Western European culture from the Middle Ages, present in painting, literature, architecture, and in music. At the end of the 19th century, in Parisian artistic salons, this style was a la mode and had particular charm. Thank you. Beauty and the Beast is a fairy tale written by French novelist Gabrielle Suzanne Barbeau de Villeneuve and published in 1740. It was influenced by ancient Greek stories such as Cupid and Psyche from the Metamorphoses written by Lucius Apuleius in 2nd century AD. In all historical periods from the Middle Ages, we can find many publications in several variants in many European countries. Popularity of this fairy tale is not accidental, as is the idea of inner human conflict between good and bad, kind and evil, divine and diabolical. It is a deep philosophical question which excited literature, music, and art in all times as a nature pursuit of man for inner harmony, catharsis, and a feeling of joy. All fairy tales are moral lessons which literature represents in simple and clear images. Beauty, in this case, is the image of an innocent girl as the symbol of patience, understanding, and forgiveness, as the symbol of sincerity, purity, all that is sometimes unattainable and difficult to seek. This is what we call beauty. Beast, as an image of a young man banished in the fairy tale for his impudence and spite, who in fact now look like an image of his soul. And this is what we call ugliness. Would anyone be able to love him in this form in the question? And the answer is yes, because there is always a hope of redemption through good deeds, but in a certain time, and for this he must strive to not perish altogether. Maurice Ravel affirms and emphasizes this in sounds through seemingly simple fairy images, but music is without words and conveys deep feelings by its nature. Before the start of music notation, composer reminds us of brief contents of the fairy tale through short fragments of dialogue between Beauty and the Beast. These are the main fragments of his composition and narrative form. Musical tale opens with a light, clear air by clarinet at the background of delicate accompaniment by strings, rhythmically similar to the beginning of the waltz. There is the beauty theme, which develops in the next bars and tails off. After a short pause, enters contrabassoon representing the Beast, accompanied by pizzicato by double basses and winds, conveying creeping steps, and the orchestra mysteriously pauses. Timid voice of a flute conveys fear, agitation, and turmoil of the beauty. Dialogue commences. Emotional strain grows, orchestral coloration thickness, dynamic increases, waltz sounds, restless and tense. After the next dialogue, there is a parallel duet as the symbol of mutual harmony and peace. It is a duet of two instruments, clarinet and contrabassoon, as two themes, Beauty and the Beast. against the background of the strings. Glissando of the harp dispels the magic spell, and the violent solo sounds as symbol of purification and reformation. This is a voice of illuminated soul in past marred by ugliness. And in the last fading slow part, the eternal theme of beauty begins anew.
Thank you.
The closing part doesn't have specific content, but it is no less symbolic and imaginative than the previous parts of this suite, and maybe even more important because the composer invites us into the world of his own fantasy. For centuries, mankind has been fascinated by the mystifying legend of fairies, of so-called wee folk, who can be kind to us humans or be mean and mischievous. The fairy garden, on one hand, is a miniature garden, complete with structures and actual living plants. It is designed to lure fairies and with them, good luck to your home. It's a tiny space created and tended with love. The design and components are limited only by your imagination, and the fairies encourage you to be extra creative in crafting the perfect abode. On the other hand, garden in literature, in art, and especially in music, is always a symbol of life. Fairies, hope, luck, or a guardian angel. This number consists of four small parts. The style of the first part is based on polyphonic four-voice sound of the strings. Slow, solemn, and lingering. It's as if the composer invites us to walk around and admire the beauty of this garden. Second part is homophonic, where tender violin melody sounds to the background of glissando chords of the orchestra. Garden comes alive before our eyes. We hear intonations of wonder and delight. Melody of the third part sounds as wide chordal sequences, widening and growing in dynamic. We hear intonations of elation, which lead to the beginning of the fourth part, a hymn to nature and affirmation of life. Harp arpeggios, accents of the triangle, celesta and glockenspiel remind us of the magical fairies. At the same time, confident chords of the whole orchestra bring us back to reality. Every fairy tale is a reflection of life.
Thank you.
Let us now remember that Ravel composed this suite as a gift to children, and therefore every fairy tale in it may be viewed as a moral lesson for the future. Sleeping Beauty, every wish comes true with patience. Tom Thumb, however you are and whatever happens, be courageous and resourceful. Green Serpent, love is stronger than magic. Beauty and the Beast, ugliness or beauty comes from the inside. Fairy Garden, life is a lot more interesting if there is fantasy in it.